grace, your mercy, all that you do for us. Bless our service, God, tonight. Bless the songs of Zion. Stir us and let us leave this place differently than the way we come. And Father, we love you and thank you for all that you do for us. In Christ's name we pray. God's people say it.
Amen. All right. I tell you what, let's do this. Just have a seat right there where you're at. We need to bring this way down. We're going to take up some prayer requests. If you've got a burden, if you've got a need, then we certainly want to share that. I don't know if anyone was able to bring any food. We've got a family in the church that could use some help with groceries. I'd like to get that as quickly as we can. If you can help us, and maybe you'd like to just do that by giving some money, and we can go and get some extra groceries. We've got some stuff over there, but we don't have everything that would be helpful. So at the end of the service, if you can help us out, we're going to do something special there. And so keep that in mind. Anyone has a special prayer request tonight?
Remember our granddaughter, she's got two more weeks.
Amen. She's expecting a girl.
Girl.
Little girl. Let's remember that. Somebody else.
Remember Gina.
Let's you remember that. I believe she's supposed to be able to come home here in another couple of months. And that's right. Let's remember those. Any others?
Y'all continue to pray for my brothers on the roads and remember my family. I sure appreciate it. Y'all have me pray.
Amen. Let's remember those. Any others? Anybody else?
Y'all remember my mom, Valentine's Day is the day that my mom passed away and he was the Lord. So I know this year's been a real struggle for my mom. With her having all these health issues and losing Papa.
Yeah, let's do remember that. Cindy's having a lot of health issues, having to go back and forth to Duke. Just about weekly. Any others? All right. We'll pray over these. We'll have a special season of prayer at the end of the service. And so let's do this. We'll let's stand up. We'll have a short time of fellowship while our teams are going to help us out a little bit on a couple of songs here. Father, thank you so much for letting us come to the house tonight. I pray, Lord, that you'd bless us. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us. I pray, God, that you'd speak to us, Lord God, in this hour. Lord God, may you help, Lord God, what's said and what's done be a help and encouragement to every child of God. We thank you, Lord, for all you've done and what you will do. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, just have a time of fellowship there.
walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to feel the same old void inside, there's a better life.
I'm not afraid to die.
is above every name, that name of Jesus. Amen. If you have your Bible tonight, we're going to look at a couple of different places. Mainly, we're going to look at 1 Peter chapter number 2. 1 Peter chapter number 2. Is everything good back there? It's all working. Everything's all right. 1 Peter chapter 2. And we're looking a couple of verses here in the book of Peter and see what the Lord has for us tonight. Let me say this. I appreciate all of you that gave and were a blessing this afternoon. Over $400 came in for our faith. And I want to say especially I appreciate Jennifer and Allison. Put a lot of work and organization into that, and we certainly do appreciate your time and helping make that happen. 1 Peter chapter 2. I tell you what, just remain seated for now. We'll get into that in just a moment. As we've, for the last few weeks, we've been looking at this idea of building together. We started looking around at how that connection is required when you build together. It's easy to just stack up together. God is wanting us to build together and wanting us to connect. Last week we talked about the foundation and building on a strong and a firm foundation. A foundation is not something necessarily someone will celebrate and someone will look at and admire. However, as the years come and go, you've got to have a foundation, or whatever you build on it will never stand. So this week, as we're continuing to look, I want to talk a little bit about this idea and continue the idea of building. And I want to say this, we need, you need, I need to keep building. Sometimes you get weary, sometimes you get tired. In fact, the book of Galatians said this, be not weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you faint not. There will be times that you get tired of building, but I believe that God has a purpose for every one of us to build something big. And you say, well, preacher, I don't know about all that. I heard somebody say this, and I thought it was good. Said, our church is not a mega church, but it is a mighty church. Amen. You may never be a part of a mega assembly or a mega this or a mega that, but that does not mean that God didn't call you and God has not equipped you to be mighty where you're at. Yeah. The Bible said this, despise not the day of small beginnings. God can take something little and build something great out of it. You say, preacher, what does that have to do with me? I don't know where you're at. I don't know what you're doing. But I do know this, that God has a purpose and God has a plan for you. And it's a whole lot better than what you've got planned, and certainly a whole lot better than what Satan's got planned for your life. So I just go ahead and grow in with God and let God have my life. Amen. Let's look at those verses now. 1 Peter chapter 2. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be that ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious. Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus
Christ. Father, I pray that you would take the Word of God, may it be applied to our heart, applied to our lives. Lord God, may we receive what you have for us. We'll thank you for what you do. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Tonight I want to talk about a few things that I've learned in this thing of trying to build something. A few things that I've learned in trying to serve God. I was surveying over some of the last years of my life, and this year at the 27th of February, I will have been preaching the gospel for 20 long years. And it's hard to look back and to believe that, but it was true. February 27, 1998, I vowed, and God done a work in my heart that I've not been able to get over yet. And God done something for me there, and I don't want to get over it. Next Sunday, will mark 14 years that I got a phone call from a broken group of people looking just to have somebody to come help them out. And as most of you know, this church is my home church. I had gone off to Bible college, and things had transpired, and the pastor that was here at the time had left, and they said, you know, can you come and fill in for us? And I was glad to do so. Had no intentions and no dreams, no desire that I would pastor here, but God had other plans. Mm-hmm. And for 14 years, starting next week, I've been trying to do just exactly that. But one thing I suppose I could learn and I could say in this idea to keep building is this. Building takes time. Building takes time. We live in a day and we live in an hour that people want things to happen, Johnny on the spot. They want things microwave. They want things to be sent to them via the airwaves, Wi-Fi. I mean, we don't. It's not good enough for us just to have internet access. We have to have high-speed fiber optic internet access. We've got to have it fast right now on the jiffy, on the spot. We want it right away. But there's some things that's going to take more than a day or two to build. There's some things that's going to take more, listen, than a 30-second prayer to get through. But I want to say this. It's time for the church of God just to make up our mind that we're going to keep building. We're going to keep on going for the cause of Christ. I remember there was a lady, my brother and I were at a church in our teenage years, and we would go over to this mostly African-American church, and I'll never forget every time that we saw these people, we would have a kind of a normal fellowship. Some every so often we'd go over there, they'd come to our church, and every time we'd see this lady, she'd look at us and say, just keep on keeping on. I want to say, child of God, tonight, keep on keeping on. You might be getting weary, you might be getting tired, but it's time for us just to go ahead and drop our shoulder and keep on pushing through. Keep on keeping on the cause of Christ. Keep building. Why? If you're in this thing very long, you'll find out if you're not going forward, then you're going backwards. You cannot stay still in this thing of living for God. If you decide, I'm just going to sit to the side, then life starts to pass you by. And you and I both know that it's real easy to get out of the practice, get out of the habit, get out of used to doing it. I don't know how many people over these 14 years that I've pastored that I've seen come and get on fire for God, and something happens. Maybe it's a work situation, or maybe it's a health situation, or maybe there was a major problem in their family and something got them sidelined, something got them pushed to the side. And I can't tell you how many people I've seen get set on the sidelines and never get back in the game. They never get back into this thing of building for the glory of God. Your finances, if you're either going forward or you're going to go backward in your finances, your health, our relationships. Did you know that most divorces didn't happen overnight? Neither does a successful relationship, neither does a successful marriage. Well, I mentioned this morning, you don't just say, hey, baby, I love you, and if anything changes, I'll let you know. It don't work that way. You've got to continue to pursue. Now, this is something I learned in Bible college. Men have this instinct on the inside of them that they love the thrill of the chase. Ladies, do you remember when you was dating and you was courting, and man, he would call you, he would spend money on you, he'd spend time, he'd write letters, man, he would do all that stuff, but then when he finally caught you, he quit.
Come on.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
you know why? Because men like the thrill of the chase once they've caught the prey.
Yes. Come on, bro.
Yes, I would say.
Can you get the point, too?
Yeah. Once they've got what they were after, I just move on. Lord, help. Praise God. Marriage is honorable. Amen. Once they've been able to win over that one's love, sometimes they feel like, well, you know, I'll just leave it be. And guys, let me help you. If you're having problems with your relationship, just remember what you did to catch her. Go back to the things that you used to say, you used to do, how you used to act when you're trying to catch her, because all she wants is to be pursued. She wants for you to want her. This is not a whole relationship issue. I'm not going to preach a long time on this, but I will say this, that there are some things in life that require a long-term effort. Our education, starting that business, your retirement savings plan, the best thing you can ever do, teenagers, is if you get a job, you start getting involved in retirement savings as soon as you can, because the best thing you can do is have time on your side, and you can be a millionaire one day, and you can pay your tithes to Maranatha Baptist Church. Amen. That goes right there. Your calling in God is going to require a long-term effort. We live in a day of quick fixes. But this thing of living for God still requires time and hard work. Now you might be asking yourself, I don't know if God's really calling me to do this. I don't know if God's really working in my life and speaking to me about doing something. Here's one glaring evidence that God may be calling you to something. Is it bigger than you? Is it more than you can do? Because I promise you this, God will always call you to more than you can do. You're always going to need Him. I learned this in Bible college and I never forgot it. Every step towards self-sufficiency is a step away from God. Let me say that again. Every step towards self-sufficiency is a step away from God. When there's something that's too big for you, something that you cannot handle, something that's over your head, it may just be the perfect will of God for your life. Things take time. Think about Moses. He told Moses, I'm going to take you to a land. There was a promised land to go to. Did Moses wake up the next morning, make a little hike, and set up shop and set up tents there in the Promised Land? No. Whenever he finally decided, for 40 years he was working with the sheep on the backside of the desert, when God finally said, all right, it's time to go. It's time for you to go there. It's time for you to go. Then it was a whole other 40 years before they ever got there. God takes some time to help them. Now listen to this. Mm-hmm. Think about King Saul. The Bible said he was head and shoulders above all the rest. They thought if I could pick a king, this would be him. And God let them pick their king. It was never God's pick, but it was who they wanted. They wanted a king like the rest of the nations, and he let them have what they wanted. And Saul ended up messing up. Saul ended up in all kinds of trouble. And then Saul ended up losing his life. But God had a little boy. God had a little boy on the backside of the desert taking care of sheep. And whenever they went to the father's house, said, bring me your boys. Which one is it? Surely it's this one, the older one. Surely it's this one. He's big and tall and strong and he's handsome. No, God has not chosen them. He said, wait, there's one little boy out there taking care of the sheep. That's the man of God said, I won't sit down till he comes. No. Till the king gets here, I'm not going to sit down. Somebody just need to go to David came. God anointed him to be king over Israel. Now get this. Saul never kept sheep. Saul was put in the position overnight, seemingly. Saul got all messed up. Now David had some problems, but God cultivated David. God used David. Can I even tell you this? God let Saul be over him. And God let David learn from that time of somebody being over. You'll never be over anything until you can learn to be under
something. That's right.
Yep.
Some of us, man, we don't want anybody to tell us what to do. Nobody can tell me what to do. And that's exactly how you're going to live your life. Nobody's going to tell me what to do. And you're going to sit around all the time. And you're going to have problem after problem after problem. Because you will never get under the authority that God has put you under.
Yep.
You might not like it tonight, but that's going
to preach it. I'm right, dog.
Listen to this. We all know this verse. We quote it all the time at Christmas. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now, God gave that prophecy to Isaiah, and you would think, Isaiah chapter number 6, King Uzziah died. He's taken out of the way. God's getting Isaiah ready. He said, Lord, here am I, send me. And you would think just a couple chapters later, God gives this promise and God gives this prophecy that a son is coming. But did it come that day? No. Did it come that the next year, in 9 months? No. It didn't come in Isaiah's lifetime. In fact, 700 years later, finally God's promise come to pass. Big things sometimes take time. Building takes time. Some things take more than a day to build. Some things are going to take more than a 30-second prayer to build. Let me ask you this. Do you believe in what God's building in you? Do you believe it's worth the time? Do you believe it's worth the effort? Keep on building. Number one, it'll take time. Let me ask you this. Have you gotten grown weary in the time frame? Have you grown weary in waiting? You know, there's a verse in the book of Proverbs that says this. Hope deferred maketh the heart sick. There are times that you wait and wait and wait, and it seems like no answers
come.
It seems like there's no answer to your prayer. There's nobody hearing your prayer. I talked about it on Wednesday night in the book of Hebrews, chapter number 11. The first part of that chapter talks about how God did all these great things, how he delivered them out of the mouth of the lion, how he turned the armies to flight, how he did all these things. But then it turns around and said, but yet there were some that were not delivered. There were some that were sown asunder. There were some that went through great trials and were chased, destitute in deserts and in caves. And you have to ask yourself, God, why don't you hear my prayer? Sometimes building takes time. Number two, it takes time. It takes toughness. We've got some fellas in here that helped us here a few years ago. We built a little addition on our house. And it was every Saturday for, it seemed like forever, that we were out there hammering and hammering and sawing and had the drill ones. And we were doing all that work and over building projects. Building is sometimes can be monotonous, can it not? We've been talking about how you can build things with Lego. And we had some teenagers trying to help me out on some of my creations here. And clear this off a little bit. Hold your ears. Tearing everything up. Warren, I appreciate your artwork. Your sculpture. Sometimes, it's Lego piece after Lego piece after Lego piece just putting it together. It's just putting it here and putting it there. Sometimes, it's something a little bit different than that. Sometimes you just have to take and mix some things up. You just mix them and you mix them and you mix them and you sit and look at it and think, is my cake ever going to come out? Is anything ever going to happen? And you just sit and wait and think, will this thing ever be good? I don't know if y'all like me, but when it gets done, I like to lick the beavers. Amen. I like to get in there and get all the goody out of that. That's all right. We put it in the dishwasher. Hallelujah. We wash it in the dishwasher. We sanitize it. You'll have to talk. Y'all need to talk to her maybe afterwards. She's got some issues going on. Thank you, Brother Larry. You go to school. You go to work. You go to work, you spend time with your kids. You read your Bible, you pray, you go to church, you get up, you read your Bible, you pray, you go to church, you read your Bible, you pray, you go to church. Sometimes it just seems like it's monotonous. It seems like I'm just doing the same thing over and over.
Come on.
But what we don't realize is God has built us up. God has put pieces together. God's letting us grow in little places. By little and little is how he drove out the giants. By little and little is how they took over the promised land.
Yep.
I said, child of God, just keep building.
Yeah.
Our life can be filled with repetitive tasks. Seems like sometimes it can almost be mind-numbing. Just the repetitiveness of it all. Some of your working situations seems like week after week it's just the same old, same old. You go through situations and it's the same, it's the same, it's the same. You're wondering if anything's ever going to change. But know this, God's waiting for the time God's got a perfect time, just like when Jesus came. The Bible said, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of a woman, in the fullness of time, at just the right time. He told Isaiah, there's a baby coming, but 700 years before that baby ever got here. Sometimes it's going to take some time. Sometimes it takes toughness. What it would do us well, every once in a while, just step back and look. How many of you know sometimes raising kids can be hard?
Come on.
You look at it, you think, I don't know if I'm making a difference. These kids are driving me crazy. I'm going to pull my hair out. I'm going to have a heart attack. I'm going to have a stroke. Y'all, I'm just testifying a little bit. All right. But you look at the situation and you think, I don't know if I'm making this. Sometimes it does good just to step back and say, you know what? I'm not just going through the motions of every week and every day and just this and just that. God's using me to build a child, to build a life. Go ahead and step back from the situation every once in a while and say, you know what? I'm not just doing this day in and day out. God is putting little pieces together every day. God's putting little pieces here and little pieces there. And God is building something. God is doing something. I'm a child of God. When you look at your life and you think, I'm all messed up. I'm sideways here and I'm way out there. And look and step back and look at your life and look where God brought you from.
Yep.
Look what God has done in your life. And stand and say thank you, God, for what you're building.
Amen.
Don't forget what you're building is important. Those kids, those teenagers. We've got any parents and teenagers. You saw us that shout amen right there. Those teenagers, they're going to be worth it. They might drive you crazy. They might give you a heart attack. But they'll be worth it. That career, that dream, that home, that life, that church, it's worth it. You're building something worth building. Listen to this. I had read this somewhere and thought it was good to share. Consistency. Consistency always results in increase. Whatever you are most consistent at, you will see increase in that area. If you are consistently in the Word, you will increase in knowledge and wisdom. If you are consistent in prayer and meditation, your ability to discern God's voice will increase.
Amen.
Likewise, the negative is true. If you consistently look for the negative, if you consistently look for faults, you'll increase in bitterness and offense. What areas in your life would you like to see increase in? Become consistent in those areas. Consistency evolves into speaking and not just doing. Somebody gave a definition, a short definition of success, and said this: success can be defined as long obedience in the same direction. Long obedience in the same direction. Every once in a while, a friend of mine will call or contact me, and they'll ask me somewhere in the conversation, hey, are you still pastoring at that church? Because I was in Bible college when I first started coming back up here. They'll ask me, are you still pastoring at that church? Like, maybe I should have moved on. They thought I would have moved on. By the way, it's very rare nowadays for a pastor to stay past 2 years in one church. If you go longer than 2 years in one church, you're above the average as far as staying. I say thank God for some people that's put up with me. Amen. I thank God for some people that's just decided to go with me. But I'm not looking around and saying, you know, is that some sort of put down? No. I'm proud that I'm still here. I'm proud that I'm still serving where God told me to serve. I'm proud that I'm still plowing where God told me to plow. I might not see all the increase. I might not see all the growth that I'd like to see sometimes. But I'm thankful doing what God's called me to do. I'm going to do it until God tells me otherwise. And I don't see that happening anytime. So you just might as well get to like me or you're missing a bunch of other churches.
Come on.
Yep.
Well.
Great.
Hallelujah. Why do we stop? Why do we quit? Sometimes we feel like we're done. We're done with our task. Let me tell you something before I get in here. I asked you just to sing a couple songs and I knew it would be long tonight. Yesterday I was contacted by a friend, Scott Campbell. He served here for a while. Many years ago. And he told me to pray. He told me some of the things that had transpired. We'd been talking off and on over the past couple months. He told me some of the things that happened. Yesterday he told me to pray. He said, I believe that God is leading them to resign where I'm at. I've been there. I think he'd been there 4 years or longer, probably. And today, I talked to him just a little while ago. He said, man, it was one of the hardest things I ever did. So I knew it was the will of God, but it was hard sitting there looking at those people that I love so much and having to say goodbye. You know, just as an aside, I've talked to a few other preachers that went through the same thing. And almost in every situation, you know what the common denominator has been? People fighting over money.
Come on.
They're fighting over the money.
Man.
I was talking to somebody that they have a very large facility. They just got paid off, and I'm talking about millions of dollars. Just got paid off. But if you got that kind of building, and you're making that kind of payment, that's a bunch of money every month that you're going to spend paying that mortgage. Now it's paid off. You know what the pastor said? He said, we're going to build a buffer in case we need a little bit of help. He said, but I'll tell you what we're going to do. Anything above that buffer, it's going to go into ministry or missions. We're not going to hoard it up and fight over it. And I say, amen.
Yeah.
I say, amen.
Amen.
Listen. We're getting way too close to the end to just be putting it up in BB&T, putting it up at the Nations Bank, putting it up anywhere and gaining some kind of interest. I say that we need to go ahead and think about what God would have us to do. How the souls of men, women, boys, and girls that can be reached, that can be affected by the cause of Christ, and that is yet churches after churches will shut down because people want to sit and fuss with us and get all in the sideways about money.
Come on.
Did the Bible not tell us this? The root of all evil is the love of money.
Yeah.
We just gotta have it. That didn't get my message. That's extra credit and it cost you nothing. The reason we often quit is because we make the mistake of feeling like we've finished building. The church I just mentioned, they were my friend, our friend, just left today. One of the things that happened was this. For the last several years, he's been laboring and working, and that church has been growing, and they've been giving, and now they got enough money in the bank that they can pay the rest of it off, and now they don't need it anymore. I'll say this, that is wicked and out of the pits of hell.
Come on.
To use somebody just to get what you want,
yep.
And then just say, I'm done with you. There's no way God will ever bless anything.
Come on, brother.
First Peter 2, verse 4. To whom coming as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, ye also as lively stones are built up. It seems that Peter may be going back to what was told him by the Lord about being built on a rock. When he looked at Peter and said, you're just a little piece of a rock, but I am the bold.
Come on.
I am the chief cornerstone. I am the rock. And he said this. He said, the church will not fall. The church will not go under. The gates of hell will not prevail when it's built on the rock. And the rock is Jesus Christ. He talks about building on that rock. In chapter 2, look at the growth here. Give me verse 2 there in the text, if you will. Verse 2. As newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word that they may grow thereby. So we're looking and we see a little baby. And a little baby needs milk to grow. Needs an opportunity to grow. Needs help to grow. But now, the Bible said here in verse number 5, Peter's writing to the same people. He said, ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house. And they started out as a little baby. Now, he said, you're a stone that can be used to build something for the glory of God. God did not intend for you to stay a baby. God did not intend for you to stay a little child. He put it inside of you to grow. He wants you to grow. It is what God expects from us.
Amen. He
said, you are built up. That carries the meaning of being built. Not that we were built and it's over. It's a continual type building. Built up. Sometimes we look and think, well, I'm finished building. Maybe it's because we just had a little vision, a small vision. The Bible said this, where there is no vision.
Come on.
The people perish.
Come on.
Maybe we just got tired. Maybe we were just lazy. I preached a message a while back about pulling it out again. Preaching on camp meeting Christians. Mm-hmm. I mean, some of us, man, we like the glory, don't we? We like to come and just shout, woo! You preaching there, right, preacher? That's my song. Y'all sing it again. We'll run around the church. But when it means to doing anything for the cause of Christ,
come on,
you running good, Doc.
Yeah. You know what camp meeting? Lord help me. I might as well just say it.
Come on.
You know what camp meeting Christians, camp meeting hobos do? They find out where the next camp meeting's going.
Yeah.
They go and they get a free place to stay. They get free food. They don't do anything. They don't give anything. They don't have anything to do with anything. But they go sit and shout. And next time you see them, they be shouting, woo! God help us. We get lazy. Maybe we don't know what to do next. Maybe I don't know what the next step is. Sometimes we get distracted. Sometimes we just, well, I thought that was all it was to it. Guys, what did I tell you? When you pursued her, when y'all was dating, man, you was chasing after her. Well, she's married, and now we got the ring. I told her I loved her. She knows if anything's ever changes, I'll tell her. You're not done. In your spiritual life, you're not done. You know, God's word never talks about retiring. At 85 years old, Caleb said, give me my mountain. Where's my mountain? The Bible said, and Joshua said, there was much land. yet to be possessed. I don't know how long you've been in this thing, but there's no getting off. There's no exit. There's no I'm leaving. I'm done. It's time for the child of God to just go ahead and fill up and go another mile. Fill up and take the trip. Fill up and say, I'm in this thing until Jesus calls me. God tells us that we shouldn't act as though we haven't already obtained. Paul said, I press toward the mark of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Can I ask you this? Are you still building? What I started off telling you is that this idea of building, how can you be successful in your building? How can you continue to build? It's going to take time. It's going to require some toughness. You know, let me just talk to the church a little while. It gets easy sometimes to just go through the motions. Just doing it, but our heart's not in it. We're not committed to building as God would have us to. Now, I promise you, I'm not trying to point anybody out or anything like that. But there's some of you that sit here tonight. You were over there in that building. I was over there in that building. I can remember when I first got real good and hungry for God. When I had to have His Word, I had to meet with Him. I had to pray. I had to have that for me to survive. After a while, we get used to it. We know how to do it. And we just go through the motions. Do you remember what it was like to have to worship? I think it was Sammy Allen that said this. Said, you've not worshiped unless you've embarrassed your flesh. You've not really worshiped until you've embarrassed your flesh. I'm not saying y'all act a fool. But what I am saying is this. Sometimes we get so dignified.
Yep.
We know when to throw our little hand up.
Come on.
And we even know how to wave our hanky just right. We know how to do it all. But do you remember?
Come on.
When you were so moved by God that it didn't matter who was around. It didn't matter who else was in the altar. You were going to go and fall on your face, and you was going to pray until you were done praying. Not until it got awkward. Y'all know what I'm talking about. There's sometimes you come down here and pray. I'll just be honest, there's sometimes I come down here and pray, and I know people are coming to pray with me, and I know they're tired, they won't leave. But I'm not supposed to yet. You remember when it was like to have to worship. To have to pray. To have to give. To have to serve. Lord, you've done so much for me, I can't help but to do it. I've got to. Do we live like we're still building? Do we worship like we're still building? Do we study God's Word like we're still building? Or do we have an attitude that just says, you know what, I'm done. I'm tired of this, I'm tired of it all. Y'all do what you want to, I'm done. What about the Great Commission? I'm getting ready to be done. What about the Great Commission? Do we as a church, I'm talking to Maranatha Baptist Church, do we as a church live the Great Commission? Do we operate in the Great Commission the way that God has told us to? Are we making disciples the way God has told us to? Are we desperately working to finish the project? Are we desperately working and going until everyone knows, until they all they can hear, until all see? Or do we act like, well, we got a nice building. We got padded pews. We got nice things. I'm done. I would be building, but I don't know if I have the right things to build with. Here's the last one. You've got to have the touch. You've got to have the touch of God. 2 Peter chapter 1 and verse 3 said, according to His divine power, hath given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness through the knowledge of him that hath called us to glory and virtue. Divine power. That's the Holy Ghost that lives on the inside of you. What is that divine power? And what does it give us? All things, the Bible said. Everything you need. You read through the Bible, some of our very favorite verses and favorite stories to read in the Bible are about people that did not have enough. David just had a little rock and a sling. But the God on the inside of him said, bring me that giant. He's going to fall. There's a woman that just had a little bit of oil and a little bit of bread. And she said, I'm going to make this cake. Me and my boys going to eat it. I'm going to die. But God said, no, no. He said, you'll live till the famine's over. You'll live. That cruise will not give out. I said, praise be to God. God's got divine power for you. Philippians 4. Verse 19 says, my God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. Just keep building. God will supply. I always wanted to preach a Lego message out of these verses, and it just kind of came here. 2 Peter 1, 5. Beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and add to virtue knowledge. To knowledge, temperance. To temperance, patience. To patience, godliness. To godliness, brotherly kindness. And to brotherly kindness, charity. Mm. Do you see? There's a progress that's going on.
Come on.
There's a building that's happening. If we're building, then we ought to be progressing. You can come to the piano. I'll just read these verses and I'll hush. 1 Timothy 4, neglect not the gift that is in thee, which is given thee by prophecy, which with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. Meditate upon these things, give thyself wholly to them, that thy prophet may appear to all. Paul's writing to Timothy. He said, Timothy, you've got the touch of God on you. You are gifted. You have a power that's on the inside of you. Don't neglect the gift. Timothy, you're called to lead. Mom and Daddy, you're called to lead. Deacon, you're called to lead. Sunday school teacher, you're called to lead. Choir member, you're called to lead. Child of God, you're called to lead. Everybody's supposed to see that you are profiting, that you have the touch of God, that it may appear to all. If there's no progress in our lives, maybe we're not building. We often come to the place, well, I failed God, I got to start over, I got to go back to square one. You know, in the book of Hebrews chapter 6, it said, lay not the foundation again of baptism, repentance, and all that. He said, but go on to these other things. Can I tell you this? One of the tricks the devil uses, one of the lies the devil tells, it's just because you got tripped up, just because you got messed up in something, that God's done with you, and you got to go all the way back to the beginning and start all the way over. See, the thing about God is that God forgives you, and he'll let you start right there.
Come on.
You don't have to go back to all this and start all the way from the start line. You might trip up here, but you can stand up. He'll wash you off. He'll wipe you off. In the case of the prodigal, he clothes you with a ring, a robe, and some shoes. And he said, you're still my child. I've got a party for you. I've got a plan for you. There's great things ahead for you. But too many times we look back and say, I'm going to go back and fix all this stuff. And God said, just let me take you from here on out. I wonder tonight how many of us may have grown weary in well-doing. God is still building you. The Bible told us this in the book of Philippians. Being confident in this very thing, that he which hath begun a good work in you will perform it to the day of Jesus Christ. God didn't call you to stop. God didn't call you to get out. He told you to be. If, won't you stay with me? If you had enough time and you had enough resources, what couldn't you do? Where couldn't we go? The Bible said this, that divine power is on the inside of us, and he's given us everything we need. I wonder right now, how many of us come and gather around these altars and say, God, will you help me in my weariness? Will you help me in my long serving? Lord, will you help me to keep on working? Keep on building. Come on. I know it's late. I know you're tired. We're almost done. Help me, God, to keep building. God, when I don't see it, when I don't understand it, Lord, when it's not happening according to my plan, not happening according to my time frame, God, help me to keep building. Oh, God. Lord, I want to be faithful. I want to be found faithful. Lord, one day, every one of us will stand before you. We'll give an account. God, Lord, I hope I can stand on that day and say I've done everything you called me to do. Help me, Jesus. Oh, God, have your will and have your way in our lives tonight. God, help us as a church to keep building. Not that we have already attained. God, be like Paul, pressed toward for the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Church tonight, and we appreciate you being here. Remember, we will not have any services this Wednesday. Won't you pray for us? We're in the finalizing a lot of stuff that we'll be starting up on Sunday. Remember, Sunday, our evening service will start at 5. It'll be a little bit different, but I believe it'll be a help to you. If you're here tonight, I hope you'll be here on next Sunday to be part of that. There's going to be a ladies' session. If you're a lady, you do not have to be part of that. There will be a mixed class here in the sanctuary, but there will be a special ladies' session that I believe will be an encouragement to you. I believe it's called When God's People Pray, and we'll be looking in the sanctuary. We'll be looking at the idea of discipleship and the anatomy of a disciple, how God builds disciples, and I believe that will be a help to every one of us, all right? He's got those plates. We need to do that, don't we? So just stand right back there at the back, if you will, Brother Joe, and if you've not had an opportunity to worship the Lord in giving, we'll do that on the way out. You give, let the Lord bless you. Again, you pray, we're looking forward to what the Lord's going to do here. next few weeks, all right?
Don't you need to take off?
Yeah, we do. We do need to do that. Thank you. We'll come here and give Grandma a helper. We're going to have a regular tithing offering. Thank you. And if you want to give to help and go, especially for us to be able to help that family with some groceries and some of their needs, we'll do that at the back, like we do at times. So if you've not been able to worship and give in your tithe that goes to the church, you can give. Fellas, make your way right now. Start walking. There you go. And you give. If you're not giving in tithe, you put that in as they come by your way. And you give. And I know the Lord will bless you for your faithfulness to give. What you give at the back on the way out will be a help toward that family that we're going to try to help. If you do have some groceries that you'd like to give, please give with me as soon as we can. We're going to try to get that taken care of as quick as we can. So if you want to do that and give groceries, you can do that as well. All right? Eric, way back in the back, you pray for us.
You know, Father, we thank this time together in your house. I pray just be with each one of us. I pray we're going to speak grace to you and we'll do your will. I don't always seek.